I'm Griffin.
And I'm Haley. And we are back to test different beers now. What'd you get?
I got the molasses porter.
All right, and I got the Golden Hour Double IPA.
And here we go.
Yes. Cheers.
Cheers. Okay, this is like sitting by a bonfire in fall with like a sweatshirt and oysters. You know, did you ever do that?
Well, I don't like oysters, but okay, the bonfire but part, yes, I wholeheartedly
agree. Yeah, this is like a fall, autumn type kind of beer, I feel like.
Does it actually taste like molasses?
You here, try it. I wouldn't say really molasses, but it has a smoky kind of flavor. It's really dark, but still at the same time not overpowering.
It's tasty. Yeah. It's good. It's like, it's got like that nice bitterness to it, but it's not so bitter that you're like, ugh.
Like the aftertaste is sweet.
Yeah.
Almost. Like a,
exactly.
Like
yeah.
A
it's
sugary,
got like that bitter initial taste and then the aftertaste. It's like pretty.
But it is definitely a beer that you would drink in like the fall to winter kind of time.
Yeah, it looks a little bit heavier. I mean, it's completely opaque, so. This one is another sort of cloudy beer. It's pretty orange. Refresh my palate. This one's got like a very like mellow bitterness to
it.
Yeah, go for it. It's not really sweet. It's very smooth. Very smooth. Goes down really easily.
Oh, wow, yeah.
But you can tell it's that sort of double IPA. Like, it does have that really hoppy, bitter flavor to it, but it's not the choke you kind of hoppy,
yeah,
bitter flavor.
Yeah, I know. What you're talking about. It's actually, like, even though it's a dark color, it still tastes light.
Mm-hmm.
Does that make sense?
Yeah, it's got that crisp sort of taste. And actually, when I sampled it beforehand, it was much lighter, but I think that just has to do with the volume of the liquid
probably
that was in the glass.
Yeah,
but I can see why they call it, I mean, Golden Hour. Like, check that out. It's gorgeous.
See, most of the time I usually go for a light beer, and like, this is a lot darker than anything I usually drink. But whenever I sampled it too, it reminded me a lot of,
it looks like a black coffee.
It really honestly kind of does. I mean, but it's not too much.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? Like, sometimes it's just like,
oh, yeah. No. No, thank you.
That escalated quickly.
Yes, exactly.
But this is not at all like that. It's something that, honestly, I mean, I like to drink it, but I think it would be really good as, like, a part of a marinade.
Mm-hmm. Like,
yeah.
Use it for cooking, add
yes,
flavor,
mm-hmm.
reduce it down.
Yes, definitely. Like,
that would be good.
I have a...
Beer brats come to mind.
See, I have a very... I love jerky.
Mm-hmm.
I don't eat meat.
Yeah, you won't eat meat unless you kill it yourself.
Yes, that is right. So
live sustainably.
It's population control, and it's... Anyways. So whenever I'm making my deer jerky, I usually like to use something... I mean, all my secret ingredients, but I like to have something as a base, and that would be perfect.
Because I feel like that one, like, if you did, like, reduce it down and you cooked it, like, do you smoke... smoke jerky, right? Stumbled over
I
my
have.
Words there, but yeah, that okay. I feel like when you reduce that down and used it in the jerky, it would sort of bring out that really sweet flavor in the beer,
yeah.
So like you would taste that more. Sort of like what you get as the aftertaste after you drink that,
especially
like
in like game meat, because you know sometimes
yeah.
stuff can be really gamey, but that tastes really good and it smells. Smell it, doesn't it smell like a smokehouse kind of?
Yes, it does,
but in a good way,
yeah, no. Smokehouse has always smelled good. What are you talking about?
I don't know, sometimes whenever I was younger, I would come home, and if I smelled like a bonfire, my mom,
Where have you been?
I was at the movies.
Yeah.
Why do you smell like fire? There was a fire at the movies.
Like, what are you talking about? I love the smell of wood smoke, honestly.
Oh, me too.
I love it. Like, it's the best.
Have you ever used a wood stove?
Like, yeah, actually,
house?
My boyfriend has one.
Really?
In his house, yeah.
See, and then everyone says that they think that it's going to make their clothes smell like smoke and everything's going to smell like smoke, but it's really not. It's actually like...
You only really smell it outside, like, unless you're stupid and leave it open so that the smoke ventilates indoors,
see,
which you shouldn't be doing
it's
anyways.
Like, but the light, smoky, an aroma, if you will, an aroma, which is actually, I think, I mean, I enjoy it. It's a part of the mountain experience, especially being up here in Boone, you know?
Yeah.
Like a wood fire and...
Well, who doesn't love s'mores? Come on. We all love s'mores.
I haven't had one. How can I have s'more? would definitely be a beer. But this would definitely be a beer that I would drink, like having s'mores by a fire.
Well, you've never watching had them. How do you know what they taste like?
Hey, you got me there. But with football, like this would be like a football, fall football. Thanksgiving's coming.
American football. If anybody's watching this anywhere else in the world, not we're talking about American football.
Not
soccer.
Football.
Football. No, sorry, that's probably not how you say it. We're being
asked. I never got into soccer a lot.
My little brother plays. He's a goalie. He likes
it. I was just a lacrosse goalie. It takes a special kind of character.
The one time I was ever a goalie in lacrosse, I got the worst bruises of my life.
That means you're doing it right.
I guess. But that's my exactly goodness, it was painful.
What you're doing
it
right.
It was painful.
See, all the good sports are painful.
Right. I mean, like, if you don't get hurt, you're not playing hard enough.
You're not doing it right. That's what I always see. I try to tell that to my athletic trainers whenever I was in school. I'm like, no, you don't understand. Like, I'm hurt because I'm doing it right. I'm just that dedicated. Especially, see, we have horses, you know. Mm-hmm. I loved
horseback riding. We only got to do that. Like, we've only done it a couple times.
Well, I know a guy.
It was so fun.
I know somebody.
I know you.
Exactly. Well, but sometimes, I mean, it can get a little out of control. So, one time my horse kicked me, but I told everyone he was high-fiving me because he kicked me in my hand. I was like, it's cool. It was just a high five. It went wrong.
It's fine. Everything's okay. Nothing's wrong. Nobody's
worried. So you said you don't drink, you don't eat oysters.
I don't.
Is it because you're not from the coast? Because I feel like being from the coast.
I'm not. Well, okay. So some seafood, I think a lot of it is the smell bothers me a lot
than the
actual taste does. But
have you ever been to an oyster roast?
Yes, once at some, like, I think it was at Lado Plantation in North Carolina.
Well, I guess up here it would be like.
But for me, with the oysters, it was the texture. They were very slimy. And actually, the first oyster roast I went to, I liked it. I was fine with it because they weren't really slimy oysters. They were like, I guess there was roasted oysters. So, like, that was okay. I didn't mind them so much. But then
did you have cocktail sauce?
Yes, and then we went to Bubba Gump Shrimp Co. in Charleston, like, a while ago. It had horrible service, by the way, which was awful. Did not expect that. But anyway, we had, like, just the regular oysters, like, just oysters on the half shell. They weren't roasted, and they were so slimy, and it really weirded me out. I don't know.
Bubba Gump Shrimp, you know that's what my life is based on.
Oh, I know.
My actual life is based on Forrest Gump.
Because your mom's Jenny, and you grew up
Yes, yep. My mother's name is Jenny, and as a child, my sister and I were homeschooled, and we lived on my dad's 70-foot steel hull shrimp boat, and so my life is actually kind of like Forrest Gump. You know how hard it was as a child.
Yes, this is my mother Jenny, and you grew up on a shrimp boat. Do you go together like peas and carrots? I can go all day.
No, really, it is exactly like that. And then people would always say, "Do you know how to cook all those kinds of shrimp? Boiled shrimp, baked." And they would really go on and on. I'd be like,
just list them. Oh my god, I could totally go for a low country boil though right now.
Oh,
that
low country
would be
boil.
So good.
They're doing really well right now, catching out there on the ocean.
We just had Hurricane Andrew.
Yeah, pushed all the seafood.
Matthew.
Andrew was years ago.
Yeah.
Andrew was.
It's hard to keep up. There's always so many. Like,
I know, North Carolina. We haven't had rain since then, though.
I know, and actually that's why we have all these wildfires happening.
I was just thinking whenever we were talking about, like, the smoky smell.
And there's
face.
All, like, that litter on the ground, like the dry leaves that have just fallen off the trees.
That has been a problem for me. So I was walking to my deer stand day before yesterday. I was walking to my deer stand, and I'm trying to be as quiet as I can. We're hunting wabbits kind of thing. And I'm like, okay, here we go. And then it's,
But in all honesty, can't we all agree though that like the best part of fall is like just deliberately stepping on the crunchy leaves? You can see a big pile of them and you just like run through them as fast
as you
can.
Not when you're trying to be quiet.
Well, okay, not for hunting, but like just on any other regular occasion, like if you're out in the world, in the city, whatever, and there's just like a big pile of dried leaves, you're like.
See, that's what squirrels do. So I'll be up there, right? And I'm sitting in my deer stand. I have all my stuff, and I'm trying to be like super still and quiet. And I start hearing. Oh my gosh, here comes Bullwinkle. Like, he's gonna walk out right in front of me, and then you. And I'll go to look.
It's just a tiny squirrel.
It's Rocky. Yeah,
squirrel.
It's more Rocky and less Bullwinkle, and it's just squirrels running around, pretending that they're something big and important.
So, we've never really had squirrels at my house, but we also have four cats, so.
There's actually
they don't stand a chance.
You know, there's a squirrel season.
Really?
Like a squirrel hunting season.
Wait, what do you, like, what kind of ammunition do you use? Like, I'm assuming not buckshot.
Oh, no.
Because that would just explode the squirrel.
Yeah, pretty much. Yeah. Well, I mean, honestly, I'm not particular in squirrel hunting just because I don't like to cook them.
Yeah, I don't know.
But actually, I have. I have done it before, and if you cook them...
How do you cook?
If you cook, if you cook them in a crock pot and you don't do it really, really slowly, it's actually not that bad.
I feel like they
you have
tough.
To clean them the right way. They're really not.
Well, how do you clean them?
Oh, God. I feel like some people would be turned off by talking about how to clean a squirrel. You can... very delicately is how you clean them. You clean them just... But they're actually, I mean, actually it's not bad. It's not as much, since they're smaller, it's not as bad as, you know, I like... Cleaning deer isn't too bad, but being a biology major, anatomy is always really interesting.
Oh my God, in anatomy in high school, we had to dissect cats.
Good.
I love to do dissections, but cats, like, I'm a crazy cat lady at heart, and that just, like, weirded me out beyond words, and I didn't like it. And then my teacher was just horrible. First of all, she never checked to make sure that we were wearing closed-toed shoes. Because, like, you know, like, theoretically, you could drop a scalpel and, like, cut your pinky toe off, you know? But she never checked to see if we were wearing closed-toed shoes. I mean,
did
in
you,
all actuality,
did you not
so
see the black and white
old.
Video before?
No, she never showed
safety?
It to us for lab safety. And, like, but in reality, these scalpels were so dull that there was no way it was going to cut you. I mean, it was almost impossible to cut through the flesh of the animal. But she made us, like, skin them, and then she kept the pelts, like, We had to go to the bathroom sinks, mind you, and, like, wash them off with just,
really?
Like, regular,
she,
like,
okay.
like shampoo, like, pert shampoo, and wash them off in the bathroom sinks, and then, like, when they dried, she kept them.
Mm-hmm.
Unless you wanted to take it home to use for something, she kept them, and she just had, like, a huge stack of cat pelts. It was so weird. My lab partner and I, we named ours, Lucifer. Ba-dum.
Yeah. So, interesting that you brought that up. So, you know, I'm going to vet school.
Yes.
I'm trying to go to vet school. But I had the brilliant idea. I started looking up taxidermy classes the other day. Because
oh my God.
if I have like a minor in taxidermy and, you know, went to vet school, then either way,
you're all right.
I'm going to be okay. Either you get your animal back and it still has a heartbeat, or you get your animal back and it's stuck like this.
Did you see that? There's like a thing on Jackass and they, like, who was it? I think it was Johnny Knoxville went around with someone dressed up as his grandmother.
Yes.
Like, just like an old lady, and he was like, "This is my grandmother, and I want to get her taxidermy." And they went around to like a bunch of taxidermists, and everybody was like, "We won't do that. Like,
no,
absolutely
it's
not."
Really, it really is. Have you seen nice taxidermy?
Have you
it's
seen
art.
Like the meme though with the fox that's horribly taxidermy, just sitting like this, and he's like, just looks really crazy, and it's like when you've had a really long week, and it's like that.
Yes.
It's just how you feel, and you're like, I relate to that.
We have
that
seen
fox in the spiritual
so
world.
I meet my younger sister, and sometimes whenever. She has friends over. My mom has to warn the parents that, you know, heads up, we have a lot of taxidermy in our house.
Just so you know.
But at the same time, though, if it's a holiday, you know Nana. We've talked about Nana. She dresses them up.
No, she does not.
She does dress
Please
them up.
Please tell me
so.
She puts, like, beards on the deer.
Yes.
Yes,
so
Nana!
So during Halloween, everything has either a witch's hat or a mask.
Cute.
And then
I would do that.
Pilgrim hats for Thanksgiving and elf hat. Nana type things.
Just
and then,
Nana things.
And then there's also elf ears and Santa hats during, but it really makes it fun. As fun as you can make, you know, a mounted animal for kids.
One of my favorite things was like my friend back in Charlotte, like we were growing up. She used to have a mounted deer butt. Like, you know how you usually mount the heads? Well, she had the
butt.
Yeah,
but you can use that as a hanger. They do that with the feet, too.
No, they do not.
They
That's
do,
hilarious.
I promise they do.
That's hilarious. These are really easy to drink. I mean, surprisingly, like...
I know. I really honestly don't like dark beer. And
but you like that dark beer.
But I do, yeah. Not to be, you know, like one of those, but...
And I don't like dark beer. It's gross. It tastes bad, and I don't like it.
Most of the time, yes. I'm not particular. I like whiskey, but I'm not really a dark beer type person.
Who doesn't like whiskey?
Mm.
Well, my mother, but that's okay.
Nana always told me that if you have to put anything more than a splash of water in your bourbon, then you don't deserve to drink it. Nana quote. Trademark Nana.
Cheers to Nana.
Cheers to Nana.
My Nana likes gin. That's how we bonded. Gin and red wine.
Your Nana is from overseas, though.
She's from England.
Your Nana's from... My Nana
so
is from...
So we always go with the first spot of tea.
See, I feel... Our Nanas are both very interesting women.
No. When... So, the drinking age over in the UK is 18. But, I went over to a... No, it's the thing. But I went over to a wedding in the family when I was 16. And we got to have... Or, like, it was an open bar, and we were all with family. And I mean, I was very well supervised, mind you. Like, I didn't drink heavily, but I had a couple drinks. And I got a gin and tonic for dinner. And so it looked like, you know, just, like, sparkling water with a lemon in it. And I was sitting there, right next to my plate. And my Nana actually accidentally grabbed it, thinking that it was her water. And she took a sip, and she just goes, "Gin and tonic, Haley?" And I was like, "Yes, Nana." And she's like... I remember it well, and just puts it back down in front of me, and I was like, "Okay, Nana, I feel you."
See,
that's what's up.
My Nana is an old southern, like old South, like
Southern Belle.
Yes, I mean I'm old Gone South. With the Wind, Scarlett O'Hara.
Scarlett.
Oh, which is coming up, by the way. So you know, on AMC they play Gone with the Wind for 24 hours on Thanksgiving Day.
Yes, so excited. So, I love Gone with the Wind.
So if you have,
we always also watch the James Bond marathons.
Is there a James Bond? We're too busy watching Gone with the Wind.
I think it's TNT, maybe.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Unless they stopped doing it, but they used to do it. That was always our Thanksgiving tradition. We just go downstairs and we'd start watching the James Bond marathon before lunch. So we do Thanksgiving midway through the day. It's 2 p.m. It's not really dinner. It's not really lunch. And then, you know, after lunch we go down and we start watching about 10 minutes of one episode, and then everybody who's sitting on the couch just passes out from the turkey coma. And we sleep to James Bond for the rest of the day.
Isn't it tryptophan?
Yes, tryptophan coma.
Do you have a favorite Bond? A favorite Bond?
Yeah.
Covalent?
No. Ha! Chemistry nerd.
Chemistry jokes.
I think actually mine would probably be Ionic, but that's not the point.
But that's not important. Peptide? Peptide Bonds? Goldfinger, I guess.
Okay. No, not episode, but Sean Connery.
Sean
Connery. Okay.
He was the voice of the dragon in Dragonheart. I think that was the name of that movie. It was where Mel Gibson's in it, and he has they share.
He's so short.
Is he? I don't really know.
No, he is.
I know he's just a strange man.
You don't ever really know, but if you see him in pictures on the red carpet, that's when you realize.
Isn't Tom Cruise really short too?
Tom Cruise is very short.
Short men are interesting. I mean, as actors, because have you ever seen Friday Night Lights?
Mm-mm.
Well, they try to perceive a guy in that show as being huge, but he's actually shorter than me.
Super lifts.
Yes.
No,
yes.
Supposedly though, short men are better lovers. Cosmo told me this, ladies. Supposedly, shorter men.
Are you citing Cosmo?
I'm not officially, but I'm just saying this is what I have heard. Okay, from Cosmopolitan magazine. Supposedly, shorter men are better lovers because subconsciously they feel like they have more to compensate for.
Really?
So they give you more attention.
Which is, being a very tall. I mean, not very tall, but above average. I mean, I'm 5'10".
Yeah.
God, you're 5'10". Yes, I am 5'10".
So
well, I mean, you know. But, I mean, that's not super duper tall. I always used to try to convince my coaches on, my stats.
You should be a model.
I used to just be like, hey, I'm 6'5 right here.
I'm 6'5
right here. That's what matters. How you feel in your heart. I'm 6'5 right here.
I believe that I am 6'5.
Hey,
actually, people look at me and be like, actually, you're 5'4, so hush. Stop. You're nowhere near that.
You know, before I wanted to be a veterinarian.
I don't think I could even reach 6'5.
I had to give up my first dream, which was to be a jockey. I wanted to be a horse jockey. That was my number one goal in life. I wanted to be a horse jockey. Whenever I turned 6 years old, and I was above 4 or 5. Had to give up that dream. So I was like, I guess I'm just going to have to be a vet.
This is where this is heading, so might as well run with it. Might as well run with it.
Mm.
Oh my god. These are good.
This makes me want to order, I don't even eat meat, but it makes me want to order a deer burger,
mm-hmm.
which I had one this weekend, and it was absolutely delicious.
I think it's the Cardinal on 105. This is a new restaurant in Boone. The Cardinal, I believe, does an elk burger, and that one's pretty good. But I could actually really go for a sandwich.
Have you ever eaten deer?
My boyfriend like hunts like you do.
Really?
And yeah.
I'm a little city girl, so I don't do that. But
actually, I really want to go. This is just the first time I've ever known anybody in my life who actually goes hunting. So,
are you sure? Would you be able to do it, or would you be like, "Run, Bambi"?
I think it would be difficult initially, but I think that I could do it. I mean, it sort of get into this debate of personhood, like we
personhood
talked about in our capstone class. It's like, you know, like, how do you assign personhood to something? But no, I mean, like, I think that I could kill a deer. He's got meat rabbits right now, and I think it would be easier for me to kill a deer over a rabbit, because bunnies are cute, and I've seen bunnies as pets, and
you don't think deer are cute? You never watched Bambi?
I mean, like, they're cute, kind of, but, like, only when they're young.
See, if you make a deal with yourself, you have to make a deal with yourself in your head, because you know what is horrible is, like, getting hit by a car.
Right.
But if you do it, it's quick. If they get hit by a car,
right, and I think I could kill a deer. You know? I mean, only like during season. Like, I don't think I would just go out and be like, nah, kill you and like leave you for dead. But you know,
no,
if I was gonna kill a deer and like
illegal.
Actually, right. But like, you know, I mean, I that's why I'm okay with hunting, because most hunters, they actually use the animal.
Oh yeah,
like,
that is one of the most important
meat.
Things.
They don't
to do.
Just
be ethical. Be ethical.
Right, like actually like use what resources you're taking.
I'm actually
and
deer tan meat, right, and tan hide right now.
Oh, cool. Let me know how it works out. But hard, yeah, like, well, hard. Deer, there was like a series that they did an app a few years ago, and it was about Yellowstone National Park and how because the wolves have died and they're like the keystone predator up there, the wolf mm-hmm. population has plummeted.
Yes, that's right.
Or had, I guess it was a few years ago. Had plummeted, and then
there's
the deer took over.
That's right.
And so what they were doing was
we're the only real predators of deer right now. Humans.
Right. And so they were eating all of the young growth,
and
all the old trees got cut down. So basically, like, all
of
the trees in Yellowstone were gone. Like, there
circle.
Was...
Right.
The
circle.
And so, and when the trees were gone, there were no, like, long-standing roots to help keep the riverbanks where they should be. So there was
domino
just tons and tons of sediment in the river. It was really bad for Yellowstone. Like, grass was dying, trees were dying. There was no, like, hardly any plant life left. The deer were rampant, and they were actually starving because there wasn't even enough young saplings for them to
eat.
They
die of starvation.
And then they reintroduced the wolves.
Mm-hmm.
And then the whole ecosystem fixed itself. It was amazing.
Yep, that's exactly.
But yeah, there's a huge problem with overpopulation of deer. And, like, I'm even from the city, and they'll hop out in front of your car there, too.
Mm-hmm. That's why we have restricted hunting seasons.
Yep.
That's the very big reason that we have restricted hunting seasons. Because they're actually more effective than any other kind of regulation that they've tried to have, because, like, overpopulation, lack of resources, they have to meet their carrying capacity, is the science.
K-value.
K-value. Science. They have to reach the right carrying capacity. A lot of them are over. See, the same thing is the abundance of coyotes is a really big issue.
Oh, God.
They are everywhere. They are pests. There's not even a season for them.
We were out looking at my boyfriend's meat rabbits the other day, and it was like, it was dark already. It was already nighttime. And
just
we heard.
Side note, that sounds like an insult, like, you meat rabbit.
Oh, no. So they're rabbits that will eventually be food. But they're really cute when they're babies. And I think the ones that the babies that he has now are going to be kept for breeding. And so it's okay that I've bonded with them already, because I keep holding them, and I'm like, I love you, like, I'm going to keep you forever. But we were sitting there holding the rabbits, and we heard this, like, all we had is flashlights, and we heard this, like, rustling. My first thought, so this is out in the country, like, my first thought is coyote. Like, oh my God, there's a coyote. And we, like, shine our lights and look, and it's just this massive white cow just sort of, like, looking at us.
A cow?
Like, what are you doing? Yeah, like, because they live back-to-back to farmland, and so there's, like, this pasture, like, next to his backyard, and it's just this cow just, like, sitting there.
Like,
hey.
Like, what are you doing?
He's just, like, straight up staring at us through the fence, and I was like, oh my God. I mean, it was huge. It was huge. It's, like, massive cow.
Cows are
all white, too. It was really creepy. I was like, what are you,
I want to work on cows mostly because, I mean, cows are resilient animals.
Yeah, no, they really are.
They super are. They're very interesting.
Have you seen, if y'all haven't seen this, Google it. There is a picture of a shampooed and blow-dried cow on the internet, and it is like a cow, but fluffy.
Ruminous.
Like a stuffed animal cow. It's hilarious. They're just so
but
fluffy, and they look really fluffy and like cute and shiny and gorgeous. But apparently cows like to groom. So, like, farmers...
They can.
Yeah, and they like to be groomed. So farmers will get, it looks like basically a giant mascara brush, but it's like a wire spool.
All I can think of now is cows putting on mascara.
But it's like this like wire spool, and it spins around, and the cows will like run up to it, and like they'll like, you know,
rub
nuzzle, like,
it, yeah.
like rub against it, mm-hmm. and it like brushes them, and it's called a happy cow machine, because it keeps the cows happy, because they'd like to be groomed. I'm not even joking.
I
didn't know about this
machine.
For a long time. Like, I saw a video of one, and then I Googled it, and I was like, oh my god, this is so freaking cute. Like, how in the world?
See, I wish I would have been that. Or the Snuggie.
You're almost done with your beer. You beat me on this one.
Oh, well, you know. I couldn't help it. It was so good.
I know. This one's good, too. I just got caught up in conversation. Cowversation.
In cowversation.
Sorry. We're horrible.
Okay, so... At the end of this, I could taste the caramel that was supposed mm-hmm. to be. Caramel? Caramel. It all depends on how it's
spelled.
No, I think it's where you're from.
Molasses porter.
But yeah, you can also taste the molasses. Speaking of cows, of course, you know that. But overall...
Caramel. Caramel is the food. Caramel.
This is a really good dark beer if you're not someone who likes dark beer mostly. But this is one of those that you can drink beside a bonfire... In the fall, in the winter, when it's cold. I don't think that this would be something I would be like, ooh, it's summertime, I'm gonna drink that. But definitely this time of year, around Thanksgiving, whenever, you know, you're hanging out with your family and everything, you know, you're
really
in a warm,
an escape.
Yes, if you're in like a warm kind of place, this is definitely.
That's like what you would drink by like the fire.
Definitely.
Yeah.
Definitely.
Like curled up in a blanket
mm-hmm.
and watching.
In a snow.
Black and white movies. No, yeah, this one's really good. I mean, kind of like the Boonshine IPA. I mean, what can I say? I'm an IPA kind of girl. I could drink this one anytime. Any time of day, any time of night, any time of year. It's great. I love it. Again, I mean, like I said, you know, you can tell it's a double IPA. It's got that, like, bitter hoppy taste, but it's mellow enough that it's not overpowering. You know?
The glass still smells really good, too.
This one still smells really good, but
I like that.
It.
I like that a whole lot. This would also be really good to say if you're like eating like a brisket or something.
Mm-hmm.
That would be the perfect beer to drink.
I would take this to like a barbecue for sure.
Really?
Mm-hmm. I think it would like go well with some nice smoked meats.
Definitely.
Just saying.
Definitely.
Or like a burger or even just like, you know, like you're just going out casually with friends and you just want to like drink a beer
mm-hmm.
randomly during the middle of the day. Anyway. But yeah. This has been Griffin and Haley and our take on the Boonshine Brewery.